Hello and welcome to the Daily Space for today, Tuesday, July 17th. I am today's host, Dr. Pamela Gay, and I am hoping this is going out because I don't see anyone in the chat. So for those of you who watch this over on YouTube, thank you. And just to let you know, we record this live every Monday through Friday, except on major holidays. And this stream goes out at 11 a.m. Central, which is, sorry, it goes out at noon Central, which is 1 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Europe, 10 a.m. Pacific. And by Europe, I sadly admit that I meant London time, and the rest of you need to do time conversions. So I am going to quickly switch views in hopes that the chat will return. Yes, I have found my chat. I have found my people. So those of you working over on YouTube, feel free to stop on by on Twitch. It's completely free, and you can be part of the chat you see right over there. Now, in today's top story, I bring you news of a series of newly discovered moons of Jupiter. These whole dozen different moons brought the total number of moons up to 70. Sorry, I can't do math in my head today, so I'm going to have to scroll and look. It brought it up into the high 70s. It's gotten to the point where listing the number of total moons on Jupiter is less important than listing how many new moons have been discovered. What is far more interesting than exactly how many moons was discovered was, well, what these moons are doing. A group of them shown in blue here in this image are in nice, normal, everyday orbits going around Jupiter in the direction that every good moon should be going in. This is the same direction the planet is rotating. The fact that Jupiter is going around one direction and its moons are going around in the exact same direction tells us that these all probably formed together, formed out of the same disk of gas and dust, with Jupiter laying claims to the bulk of the material, and, well, 70 some odd remnants getting the opportunity to live their lives as independent moons. Now, the three new prograde moons that have been discovered are on extraordinarily similar orbits. It's thought that it just might be possible that these moons were all once upon a time a single moon that was, well, struck by something bigger and madder and capable of shattering it to bits. So these three moons tell us a story of interplanetary woe and moon destruction. Moving further out, there was a whole series of retrograde moons also discovered. The retrograde moons of Jupiter are, as their name implies, moons that orbit in the opposite direction of what we would expect. Some of these may be captured objects, but it is also likely that a variety of these are actually objects that once upon a time were bigger, were all part of one thing. And that one thing got hit so hard that, well, the shattered bits that remained found themselves orbiting in the opposite direction of everything else. Now, in addition to these three correct-facing moons, this whole set of backward-facing moons, we have one moon to round out this dozen that is doing everything wrong. And by this I mean it is orbiting at a distance that makes it consistent with the moons that are orbiting in retrograde motion, the ones that are going backwards, but it's actually orbiting forwards, and it's on a highly tilted orbit. This means that while it has so far managed to escape direct collision, its days are numbered. Due to, well, orbiting opposite of everything else, it's doing the lunar equivalent of trying to drive the wrong way down a one-way street. When the street's empty, you can get away with it. But during high traffic times, you're going to get into a head-on collision. This moon is likely to, at some point, be crumbled to pieces or merged into something else as collisions, well, work to end its days. So this is an exciting bit of news. Once again, we have three moons that were probably once upon a time all part of the same larger object that are orbiting, well, in the same direction that Jupiter is spinning. We have 8 moons that are orbiting in the opposite direction of Jupiter's rotation and a much greater distance. These probably have a much more harried past. And then we have one weirdo object. And that weirdo object is orbiting with the backwards orbiting objects in a forward direction. Now, due to its odd nature, that one oddball object has actually been given a name. The other objects, as near as I can tell, are still waiting to be named. That one oddball object is named Veltudo. This is a name after the Greek goddess of hygiene, of all the strange things. And this is, as all good moons are, a relation of Jupiter's. In this case, it's Jupiter's granddaughter. So Jupiter's granddaughter is unfortunately on a suicide path in the outer orbits of Jupiter's moons. So I think I have killed that story before the moon has been killed, and I'm going to move on to another tale of planetary discovery. In this case, it's not in our own solar system that we're doing the exploring. Rather, a team of scientists decided to see if Kepler data, in this case Kepler 2 data, could be used to discover far out planets that are orbiting at great distances from their host star. In general, when Kepler and K2 discover new objects, it's because those objects have passed directly in front of their host star multiple times. Once could be anything, twice, well, that doesn't tell you it's the same object you saw before. Three times, that tells you that you've had the exact same object pass in front of your star once, twice, three times with equal orbital periods between the first and second and second and third orbit. Now, because Kepler and K2 haven't been doing their planet-finding missions for decades, we can't yet find planets that orbit for even one decade. In order to try and overcome this, A team came up with a new idea of exactly, well, how we might do this research. In this particular work done at the University of Geneva, scientists decided to pore through the Kepler data and the K2 data and look for instances where the planetary transit, that moment of the planet blocking sunlight, starlight, from its host star, where that transit lasted not for minutes, not for maybe an hour, but actually lasted for hours. This long duration eclipse is indicative of an object that's just sort of plugging along nice and slow at the orbital speed that makes perfect sense for one of these decade-long orbiting objects. In the graph that you see at the top, I guess it's over there, you see one long dip in the light of a particular star. That dip between 3130 and 3140 days, that dip is indicative of a multi-day eclipse that took place. This, in turn, is indicative of a orbit of a decade. Now, we still don't have multiple confirmations. It would be nice, but All of this is completely consistent with that 10-year orbit. And so there is a good amount of confidence that if we look 10 years from now, we'll see once again this multi-day transit occur in this distant object. Now, for those of you wondering just what is the name of this object, I'm afraid we have another license plate today. This is the light curve of EPIC 24884794. So hopefully it will also get a better name in 10 years when this object is hopefully once again seen. Now we have one final news story for you today, and this is another exoplanet story. In this case, we have a case of, well, almost stolen identity. In the bottom panel, you see Beta Pictoris B. This is a nice, friendly little exoplanet that has been massively studied. The reason it has been studied so much is, well, the star that that planet is going around is a star that is so bright. You can go outside, see it with your own eyes, and go, yeah, that's bright, because it even appears bright to our eyes when compared to the surrounding stars. This bright star is nice and easy to observe from here on the ground, and its little planet goes around rapidly enough that we can detect it on a regular basis. Now, its little planet is such that we can actually measure how much light it reflects in different colors. This is called a spectrum. By studying the infrared spectrum of the planet, we can start to tell different details about its temperature, about how big it is, about how it's composed. Now, this is all exciting. It's great to have data. But to bring you to today's news story, there's another planet that is doing its best to look just like Beta Pictoris B. This particular planet is 2MASS0249C. Again, a license plate planet. This particular planet, however, is similar in size, similar in just about everything to that planet around Beta Pic, but because it orbits a little tiny red dwarf, there's no way it could have formed the way Beta Pic B formed. This is because in the large star system, in the system with a large star, Beta Pic, it was possible for Beta Pic B to, while the whole system was forming, form like any normal planet. Star is in the center, there is a disk of material around it, and Beta Pic B was like, I shall gravity take this, I shall gravity take this, and it grew in size over time out of what we scientifically call the solar nebula. Now, in its red dwarf system, 2MASS0249C didn't have these opportunities. It actually had to steal material that otherwise was destined to become part of that home star. So we have a tale of two worlds, one imitating the other in everything but origin. And what makes this story so amazing is this shows us that it's not just one story of planetary formation. It's many stories of planetary formation. And there are multiple ways that you can have objects forming that look identical and formed in completely different ways. Now, that concludes today's stories here on The Daily Space. This show is supported by you. Please consider giving us a follow so that you'll know whenever these new episodes are starting up. Miss an episode? Check us out on YouTube. Want to sustain our show? Please consider, well, giving us a subscription. And remember, every bit helps. The Daily Space is produced as part of CosmoQuest. CosmoQuest.org is your place for learning and doing science. Please join us over on our website and help us map out other worlds. Whether you want to explore Mars and help us determine when it last had active volcanism, or explore our own Earth and, well, see what it is the astronauts took photographs of. Whatever you do, you're contributing to people being able to accomplish science that, well, they couldn't do before. So thank you so much for being here. This is a collaboration of the Astronomical Society of the Pacific, which is our leading institution, working along with the Planetary Science Institute and Youngstown State University. So thank you, Anna. I'm going to go ahead and put back the picture of Jupiter because it's kind of the prettiest for the day. And I'm going to say, if you have any questions, please go ahead and at CosmoQuestX in the chat. Hello, Scott. Welcome. Hello, everyone else. I see on our list of viewers, Guido, Noel, Susie, Astro Helg. I have no clue how to pronounce your name. I'm so sorry. Commander Root, Decaf Smurf. That seems like a very boring Smurf. Denizen of Earth, Dustin. Electrical Skateboard, Fenrig, Graham, Hanny, Jandruloon, Larry, Marmart, Searle, Michael, Peter, R.P. Schwartz, Scott, Slow Cool, Stay Gold Pony Boy, Tom, Uncle Bill, V&K, Violet, Virgo, and Wilbur. So welcome all of you, and thank you for joining me for this episode. Now I'm going to click over and look for your questions. So I see coming in from CosmoQuest, did Juno or Earth-based observatories find these moons? The moons were actually found with a 4-meter telescope at Cerro Tololo down in Chile. This telescope has attached to it the highly sensitive Dark Energy Survey Telescope. While designed to explore our distant universe, astronomers have been able to competitively request time to study our own solar system. These moons were all found while the research team was actually looking for objects in the outer solar system, whether they be newly discovered dwarf planets in the Kuiper Belt or perhaps that elusive, well, Planet Nine. Well, we don't know yet if they found any of those things. We do know they did find these moons while looking, well, at the rest of the solar system. So Fenrig asks, do we know what sizes these newly found moons are? Yes. All of these things are listed in a paper that has just been accepted to the Astronomical Journal. I'm now trying to find out if I can get to this paper on a public site. Let me actually get back to you with that information so that I don't have to try and Google while talking to you. They are all in the Astronomical Journal article. Do we have any other questions? I see that Graham is asking, and again, please at me so I can find these things. Graham is asking, excluding dark matter and dark energy, what astronomical theory would you like to solve? So one of those things that is a disturbing enigma to me and may not bother other people the same way is we don't actually know for certain if gravity is, as Einstein put it, a geometric construct where our universe, were we able to see it in higher dimensions, is actually deformed in ways that drive how we experience gravity, that there's actually a curvature of space that leads to, well, changes in how time passes from one observer to another. We could be looking at that geometric argument, or there could be a particle physics explanation, just like we have for all the other major forces. I wish we knew if the geometric argument was actually reflecting reality, or if it was a shortcut to understanding how the particle physics actually works. If we could answer that question, it would help us know, do we have the ability to someday understand what's going on within the event horizon of a black hole? It would also just well, make me feel more comfortable with my understanding of the universe. So this is my personal want. It's probably not the most scientifically interesting thing out there, since the equations we have do accurately describe what we observe, and we know we have problems with the insides of black holes and things like that. But it's what I'd really like. I can totally get you the YouTube link. We actually somehow ended up with two different CosmoQuest YouTube channels, and we need to figure out how to fix that. And I haven't yet. These are the things that keep Susie, Nancy, and I up at night. So let me get you the link for that. And I will look on figuring out, once again, how to better link all of our different YouTube content. So at the link I'm about to pass you, you can find all our YouTube content. So do we have any other questions? There's Fenring chiming in again. Maybe general relativity is to gravity as temperature is to thermodynamics, an emerging property. Yeah. Or, well, I would have phrased it the other directions, general relativity and thermodynamics, and gravity and temperature. I don't know. There are days when I don't know if general relativity is like Kepler's laws of planetary motion or like Newton's theories that gave us a force explanation. I want to know, is geometry of space actually warped? Or are there particles? Or is it an answer that allows both to be true simultaneously? Again, this doesn't seem to be the kind of thing that disturbs other people the way it disturbs me. So I'm being asked if we can get 3D with stereo YouTube channels. I don't think that's a thing because we don't have the right cameras to do it. If gravity was quantized, what would that mean for Zeno's paradox? I have no idea. Let me think on that one. That's a hard question. Thank you, Rosen Michael, for the bit. I think you're looking at a reality that has suffered a great deal of contraction. Such that time is passing for us so slowly that your bit will have time to gain interest, to pay for everything by the time the stream slows down and pops back out into a future Earth. If only that were true. So Scott is asking, is there a consumer telescope that can view something on the moon that would prove to my friends that we went to the moon? No, unfortunately okay, before I lie. There are consumer telescopes that can prove it if you also bounce a powerful laser off the moon to demonstrate that there are corner cubes there that will reflect the light back. Other than being able to reflect laser light off the corner cubes and detect it. And while you can do this with a consumer laser and a consumer telescope, you're gonna have to like use pro-grade detectors to do this. Really, you just need a spacecraft to see things. The argument that I found works fairly successfully is both Japan and India have been able to image and on their websites post images of the Apollo bits and pieces that were left behind. I don't think that a NASA conspiracy would have the power to sway these particular other countries Into admitting, yes, there is wreckage, not wreckage, there is remains of U.S. spacecraft. There's also wreckage, but not of Apollo's. There is dead robots all over the moon. It's tricky, tricky, tricky. Do we have any remaining questions? I do admit I only have 4 more minutes today because of our regular Tuesday meetings. Yes, Pharaoh, it's the space show. It's the Daily Space. We do this every Monday through Friday, except for major holidays. And we do it at the same time every day, so you can count on us to be here. Rosen Michael 123, sarcasm runs deep. Thank you, Hanny. I really enjoyed doing the Ridiculously Human podcast. It was a good interview, and it was the kind of interview where I could see that I was having an impact on just the people I was talking to, and it was a safe place to discuss hard topics. Yes, Fenrig, it is difficult that CGI can recreate anything. And I had the realization the other day that everyone who is old enough to remember the very first Apollo moon landing is now in their late 50s. So you figure they had, well, mid-50s, I guess. They had to have been born later than 65 and probably, I mean, earlier than 65 and probably closer to 63 in order to be old enough to remember it. This means that we now have to turn to, with little kids, grandparents to have a memory. And we're losing the generation that was adults when the Apollo missions took place. So soon this is going to be like the Titanic, that when the movie is made, the children assume it's fiction. So hopefully we can get back and we can have new stories to tell that allow us to constantly remind people of the history of where we've been in the past. So I do have another meeting to get to. So once again, this has been The Daily Space. I am today's host, Dr. Pamela Gay. I will be back here tomorrow at 1 p.m. Eastern, 10 a.m. Pacific. That's 6 p.m. to people who share the same time zone as London, and the rest of you get to do math. This is a production of CosmoQuest. We invite you to join us on CosmoQuest.org as we do citizen science projects to explore our solar system. We are sustained by you. Please consider giving us a subscription, and every bit really matters, especially when they add up. So thank you for your ones bits. We do appreciate those. So I'm going to have to see you on the other side. Oh, I will be back just for a different show tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern. That's 8 p.m. Central, which happens to be 11 a.m. in Sydney on, well, tomorrow. So 9 p.m. Eastern is 6 p.m. Pacific. I'm going to be holding astronomy office hours. Bring me all your questions, large and small, and join me while I continue to do a simulation of the Kelp B solar system and its little moon that is in the process of being destroyed. Thank you, Trekker Kev. That is awesome. Can we get some rocket launches for all the bits that we got today? Thank you so much, and I wish I could give you real rockets in thanks. Although you'd need a big yard to support them. Okay, anyways, thank you everyone, and hopefully I'll see some of you tonight. Wherever in the world you may be, have a fabulous morning, evening, or afternoon. And remember, go outside and look up. Bye-bye.